please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
This is Bazaar Morning Call, live from the CNBC TV18 headquarters in Mumbai.
Good morning. Welcome to Bazaar Morning Call. I'm Lata and with me are Anuj and Sonia. Well, it may be freezing cold at Davos, but it is smoking hot on the bourses. You can look at any index you want. The Wall Street indices were up 0.25% when the government shut down and were up over 0.5% when the government shutdown ends. Asia again in the green, Indian indices ending at the highest point, and it looked like actually they were in a rush to reach 11,000 yesterday itself. So today we could well be celebrating 11,000 and 36,000. That would be a double party. And good reasons, you know, that's the most important part. Look at the numbers we've got from IMF. Indian growth numbers have been maintained at 7.4 and 7.8, but global growth, I mean, that's where the real engine of this bull rally lies. They have been actually upping the forecast. Yes. I can remember from 2008, the IMF, with each passing meeting, actually reducing the global economy forecast. This time for 2018, it's upped by 0.1%. For 2019, it's upped by 0.2 percentage points. So, you know, that you just can't argue against a global growth engine. That's as real as it gets. So it doesn't like that. It looks like we should put back the cork into the champagne anytime soon.
Yes, that's well put. Lata, morning. Anuj, morning. We started off by seeing those breathtaking visuals of the Swiss Alps and all that's happening in Davos, right? But that's important because it's the first time an Indian Prime Minister is going to Davos in, what, 20 years and addressing the who's who. I guess that's nice at a time when our own markets are hitting all-time highs. But Anuj, morning. You were speaking about this all of last week that, you know, we could be going through some sort of a melt-up phase in the market, and that's pretty much what's playing out. 11,000 is—it's just a matter of few points here and there. But is this a bigger story playing out here?
Morning, Sonia. You know, it is—you know—it is clearly a melt-up, and we spoke about the possibility last week when the Nifty was at 10,500. That probably an expiry week. I just want to give some numbers. You know, I was talking about it yesterday. You know, in closing bell as well with Surabhi. Look at the market cap addition yesterday for top two stocks. TCS yesterday added 31,000 crore market cap. Reliance yesterday added 25,500 crore market cap. And by the way, there's a bit of a battle right now between the Ambani and the Tatas for the top slot. Both are at 6 lakh crore market cap. We were discussing 2 months back, you know, how do companies like Amazon add so much market cap in a single day? You know, you can feel it. And that's what happens, especially if companies grow. And, you know, on large base, if they're growing their earnings. So TCS yesterday added almost 60% of Tech Mahindra market cap in 1 day. And Tech Mahindra is an index stock. You know, don't lose sight of that. Addition in TCS and Reliance market cap yesterday is greater than market cap of 10 Nifty companies. This is what melt up looks like. And look at the delivery buying yesterday in big names. Reliance was 700 crores. TCS was slightly lower, 300 crores. Axis was about 400 crores. And my sense is Axis might well be the one that could, you know, start to take some kind of leadership. I mean, that's my base case. Let's see if it plays out. But 11K is here. It should happen with a gap up, perhaps. What next? Let's not forget that it's taken Nifty 7 months to move from 10,000 to 11,000. 10,000 first happened in July 2017. And from July to December, market pretty much consolidated between 10,000 to 10,500, while mid-caps ran amok. So there's a good chance that the move from 11K to 12K is now led by large caps. And large caps are the ones where you have seen a bit of a breakout, bit of a comeback. And the bank Nifty is again, you know, taking over leadership. So my sense is, again, it's a market where call for correction is more of a hope for correction. So many people have missed out on this market. It's a hated bull market for a lot of fundamental investors.
Also, a point that we were making last 2 weeks back, where we said that, of course, FI participation was lacking all of last year. But this year, now we're starting to see FI money come back. Yes. I was speaking with Cesar Mastery, who also said that now within emerging markets, Brazil and India have come back and topped the charts. You think that could be lead the fresh leg?
You know, it could happen. Because, you know, Indian and Brazilian markets have actually underperformed the rest of the emerging markets. And if the earlier allocations are towards these markets, you know, the point here is how to participate in a market like this now. Because for those who have missed out, I know a lot of people who have not been buying this market from 9,500, thinking that maybe a 10% correction will come. Now, 11,000, if a 10% correction comes, that's still at 10,000, right? So you might as well buy in a bull market, and if it corrects, then you buy more. It's simple as that. And of course, get some risk management in place, get into quality stocks. But I think expiry, of course, normally favors the bulls. So maybe we have 11,000, and after that, it will be interesting to see if there's some profit taking at 11,000, or you see a, you know, further rally from here on. But next time a dip comes, 200, 300 points, that will be the best buying opportunity, because once again, the market should repeat this template of rewarding those who are buying the dips.
Okay, well, there was another thing that, I don't know if Masri said that or there were other global experts. You know, 2017 was perhaps the first time that we had a rally without a 10% correction, even in a single occasion. Yes. That may happen in 2018. So, you know, the courage to buy at 200 points dip should remain, because it's, you cannot have two continuous years when you don't have any correction at all. Mm. That correction could also come. But yes, it looks like the last bear is in now, or almost getting in there. So let's keep that also on the table.
Yes, and global growth is not going unnoticed. IMF pointed it out. Cesar Mastry also was telling us how fundamentally things are improving. It's not just
look at these numbers. See, 68% of S&P 500 companies have surpassed earnings. 85% have surpassed sales. 85% have surpassed sales expectations. And in the last 1 week, 27 companies announced numbers. Not a single one of them lowered their guidance. And apparently, that's a bit of a record. It comes from FactSet in the US. So, I mean, there's no denying that global growth isn't something. And El Arian is asking whether we are in a new normal.
Yes.
That itself is saying a lot about the global growth. But I would still want to just warn about this. When people like El Arian and, you know, very sober investors are all in terms of bulls, let us also remember that bull markets shock you when the last bear has become the bull.
Okay, guys, fasten your seatbelts. Mount 11,000 could be here today.
And 36,000. Don't forget that. Okay. I think you're getting a double top today.
Okay, well, we'll brace ourselves for that. Let's tell you what our wise experts have to say as we head into trade this morning. Shankar Sharma, he's tweeted that emerging markets in dollar terms are still 10% away from their 2008 highs. With a weakening dollar and strengthening commodities, he expects emerging markets to take out the 2008 dollar high easily and then march on to greater highs. Get set for a super 2018. India will bask in reflected glory too. He's been bullish, especially on mid caps and small caps.
Absolutely. Well, actually, you know, speaking of people opting out, Anuj, I've heard quite a few people opting out of small and mid-cap. Mm. But I've yet to come across anyone who says he's not all in the markets. Everyone I meet, like, you know, wonder, will this continue? All our money is in. That's the way, you know, people normally are asking. And that caution is welcome. As long as there's caution, I always feel the markets should do well. Well, some more opinion here coming in on equities. Aditi Singh of Ambit says the current Indian bull market is all set for a final frenzy. Post the pause in the closing months of 2016, the market rallied strongly for a year, and history shows that bull markets last for 2 years post a pause. In the final stages of the bull run, the champion sector in the rally rockets up, and the financial sector is rising in such a fashion. In the closing stages of a bull run, the market PE shoots up, and the Sensex's trailing PE has risen from 17 times to 24 times in the past 12 months. But that's trailing PE she's talking about.
Okay, well, that's Aditi Singh of Ambit. But let's move on and get you some money market views this morning. Bhaskar Panda of HDFC Bank says any rally around or around the 64 mark is meeting with customer selling. For today, he expects a range of 63.70 to 63.90 to hold.
Today at long last, actually, the dollar moved up. I think we should pull up the dollar index. It was stuck at that 90.2 for the longest time. After the shutdown ended, the dollar index has moved up, and that might be a little bit of a pressure on the rupee, which will of course be welcome pressure. Well, there's the dollar index. Okay, moved from 90.2 to 90.36. On the bond markets, Bhaskar Panda says the yields of the Indian benchmark is trying to find a base just above 7.40. He expects today's range to be between 7.44 and 7.48.
Okay, over to Ronit then for the world view.
As Anuju said, you know, global melt-up is clearly happening in global markets. And the US, they hit another all-time high with the Dow Jones as well as the Nasdaq hitting all-time highs. Dow Jones clearly trading about 26,000. The Nasdaq clearly firmly trading above 7,400. But one of the reasons were the members of the Senate, they've reached an agreement to end the shutdown of the US government and the intent to keep this till Feb 8th. So another 2 weeks there for another bill to come through. Moving on to an individual stock, Netflix, that has gained more than 8% post-market as they've added almost 83 lakh subscribers in the last quarter. Remember, the market cap of Netflix has reached $100 billion right now. Moving on to the European markets, they've closed mixed with the FTSE, a slight underperformance coming there. And individual sectors, the telecom stocks, they were one of the top gainers. As reports indicated, the top two telecom companies, Deutsche Telekom as well as Orange, they may go for a merger in 2018. Beyond the Asian markets, they've opened dark in the Korean with the Nikkei outperforming there close to a percentage of higher ahead of the Bank of Japan meeting. And moving on to the SGX Nifty, that's close to Mount 11,000 over here. Back to you.
Oh, yes, that it is. It's almost 10,995. So the SGX Nifty is almost reaching over there. At the futures, it shows the way. Well, here's some important conversation that's coming in from Davos as the World Economic Forum kicks off. It kicked off in Davos yesterday. Tata Sons chairman N. Chandrasekhar spoke with Shireen Bhan, my colleague, and he laid out the group's roadmap for 2018. Well, Chandrasekhar says this will be the year of restructuring and growth for the Tatas. Remember, he has spoken about all the consumption companies coming together. Watch out for hints on that.
I think it will be a combination of restructuring as well as focusing on growth. Clearly, we have six or seven verticals we've identified, apart from steel, motors and TCS. Definitely consumer and retail, financial services and
the
infrastructure.
The market seems to be excited about the consumer-facing businesses in hope and anticipation that there is going to be some significant changes there. Is that accurate?
I think, you know, we are looking at it very deeply because there is a significant opportunity for the group considering the brand and the consumers that we already have, a very large customer base. There's a lot of synergy. So we're looking at that. And we are also trying to see how we can leverage digital in that segment and other segments. Mm-hmm. So I think lots to do.
So what would be the priority when it comes to the consumer-facing businesses? For instance, whether it's Tata Global or it's your retail business, etc. What is the overarching vision that is going to define the way that you go about these businesses?
I think each one of these areas will definitely have the same themes play out. Simplification will be a theme that will play out. Consolidation will be a theme that will play out wherever it's possible.
Is it possible in the IT businesses? Because that is a question that I last asked you, and that seems to be, again, something that the market is anticipating, whether it's Tata Elxsi and so on and so forth. There's a lot of activity around those stocks.
See, in the IT business, TCS is a very, very large player. And the other players we have are small, and they are focused on niches, and that's not an area I'm ready to comment upon. But in many of the other businesses like consumer, retail, etc., we need to see, because some are listed companies, some are unlisted companies. So how do we bring the power of the group together is something that we are looking at, multiple options at this point.
Do you start addressing the cross-holding issue as well in 2018?
Yeah, see, I think simplification means many things. Removing the cross-holding is one of them, which we have done quite a bit, and whatever left we will complete. Consolidating is another option where sometimes we may feel that a couple of
companies can come together. Which is the vertical that you see ripe for consolidation, most ripe for consolidation today?
Whether it is ripe or not, the verticals
or need
that
for.
I think the consumer retail and infrastructure, these are areas in which there's a lot of opportunity and we need to pay attention, which we're looking at.
How satisfied are you with where things are at Tata Motors? Because that again was a focus area that you spoke of in October when we last met.
I think what we have done this year, I'm extremely happy. I think the focus that we have brought in terms of commercial vehicles, where we really are going for market share gain, as well as operational improvement is working very well. And passenger cars also is doing well. I think Tata Motors' domestic market has been an area where there's a lot of action. And I've been pretty happy with where we are, but long way to go.
Markets are looking pretty good this morning. A bright shade of green. Hang Seng is up almost 240-odd points. So brace yourself for 11,000. Our research team is here to give you the list of top 10 stocks you guys need to watch as we head into trade today. So let's welcome all of them. Anuj, what are you looking at?
So Sonia, for some time I've been pointing out about a move in Larsen and Toubro. And this is a market which is in phase two of a bull market. And in this phase, normally you see economy-facing stocks do well. Earnings are picking up, economy is doing well, you know, all these forecasts clearly helping. So normally you see that move. And you know, when Larsen moves the market, it, you know, feel good about it because, you know, you think that economy is doing well. So it's up 11% this month already after spectacular finish to 2017. The stock that's playing catch up is BHEL. Yesterday had a big move, up 13% this month, but still 14% off its highs. Huge bounce from the 200-day moving average on daily charts. You know, stocks which bounce from 200-day moving average normally have good follow through. And of course, then, you know, if you're looking at mid-caps, chemicals as a space has made a huge comeback over the last two or three days. So, you know, stocks like Make Money Organics and Nosil, both of these stocks had big bounce from 20 and 50-day moving average, and both of them have moved within 9 to 10% of the, you know, all-time highs. So if that bull run is continuing, maybe in that case the correction is over and these stocks make a fresh high. That would happen. But, you know, the larger conviction, of course, is with the large caps at this point in time.
Okay, well, point taken. Actually, yesterday, I don't think any market went down. I'm just looking at all the markets yesterday. I think Argentina went down. And then the metal index was in the red. Otherwise, just about every market is up between 0.5% and 2.5% yesterday. And, you know, speaking of of Larsen, actually yesterday was more a value catch-up day as well. IT and capital goods, the two of them that didn't participate in the big 2017 rally seemed to be spearheading. So it was a huge amount of value catch-up perhaps, or catch-up of value stocks. Well, the numbers, the only one that stood out in terms of a bit of a disappointment was the Asian Paint numbers, wasn't it, Mangala?
That's right, Lata. Not clearly painting a pretty picture, so to say, as far as Asian Paint is concerned. Revenues missed estimates. The company did maintain their margins, but that was despite higher crude. They did a lot of belt tightening, so that is a disappointment. Volume growth of 5 to 6% versus expectations of 11 to 12% on a favorable base is something that the street perhaps might not like, because the revenue growth of 10.5% came on the back of a 6% price hike that the company had earlier taken. The EBITDA, that one grew by 18%. Margins improved, and this despite gross margins declining by about 150 basis points because the company cut down on ad spends, they cut down on some other expenditure, and they did undertake some sort of belt tightening measure. So the net profit growth came in line with expectations, but the street is really worried about how many margin levers does the company have going forward, because crude prices are up about 23-24% year on year. If you take a look at the fact that company hasn't taken a price hike this year, southern markets, there is a lot of competition coming in from Nippon and their home improvement space. If the company does go ahead and improve that or make some acquisition, it will be margin dilutive in the near future. Competitors are doing fairly well, so that is also a bit of a concern. Can the company go ahead and maintain its valuation premium that it enjoys over the sector or not is the big question. See the stock in a bit of a red, but the way the markets are, maybe that red tick would be bought into. Let's hear out what the management had to say in the earnings call yesterday.
There was some tightening of the belt that we had undertaken on some of the expenses. Plus, there have been some investments on renewable energy, which has also helped our power and fuel costs. So all these things add up to that 6% sort of negative number versus last year. There have been some costs which we have tried to control this year, like I mentioned, power and fuel. Apart from that, even I think the marketing spend this quarter have been low versus compared to last year.
Demand in the south was not very good, partially because of an extended monsoon in that lasted later. We have seen it revive in the month of December, so it's very tough to put these things really down.
That's Asian Paints. Keep in mind, in the past, if there has been any earnings disappointment or perceived earnings disappointment and the stock falls, normally that's been the buying opportunity. But let's move on. Yesterday, we saw that big move in Axis Bank. Abhishek, what are the key takeaways from the conference call?
Well, Anuj, in the conference call, the management actually mentioned the stress in the balance sheet. So while in the presentation, they gave the stress of funded BB rated portfolio, and in the con call they mentioned about non-funded part also. So if you take both together, it comes at around 21,120 crores. So that's up about 6.5% on a sequential basis. But if you remove the watch list, this book stands at 15,000 crores, which is up 18.5% on a sequential basis, which is a bit of niggling worries for some of the brokerages. They have also maintained their credit cost guidance between 220 to 260 basis points for FY18. They also expect NIM to improve ahead as they have got equity infusion and loan growth is actually on the healthier side. They have also mentioned that IFRS, they are seeing it troubled, difficult to implement as on April, and the delay in implementation can have a negative impact on the bank. Now, from the presentation, what I've picked up is that the retail net slippages, if you look, has come in at close to 600 crores. So if you look at YOY or quarter on quarter, this is more than double. Now, amongst the brokerages, largely, you know, it has been a mixed set of reaction from the brokerages. While CLSA has increased their target price, you know, they have cut their earnings estimate. Nomura has also increased the target price, but they have actually rolled over. Across brokerages, there is a mixed review. Back to you.
Okay, I take your point. I mean, Abhishek is pointing out to legitimate worries that the double B and lower, amount of loans has gone up a bit quarter on quarter, and that could be a niggling worry. But Abhishek, in spite of it, price targets have been increased. That is a mark of liquidity in the markets. Okay, now to you, Sonia. Tata Motors, what's the news?
Well, reports are indicating that Jaguar Land Rover will temporarily cut production at their UK Halewood plant. Now, remember, they have been telling us in the past as well in the quarter two conference call that UK and US have slowed down. So, you know, there is, in UK particularly, there's a lot of weakness in demand because of what happened with Brexit. And also, tax hikes have taken place on diesel cars, so demand has slowed down a lot. The management had already guided for tough conditions in Q2 conference call, so it's not new. But cutting off the production just indicates that, you know, they are slowing down as far as that is concerned. I spoke to a lot of analysts. They say that the Halewood plant particularly makes Evoque, a product which will anyway see weak demand because a new Evoque is coming by the end of the year. But given that they are cutting production, I expect the stock to be in the red today.
Okay, that's Tata Motors. Was up 1% yesterday, but could see some profit taking. But Just Dial came out with numbers. The stock is in F&O ban after that huge 9% move yesterday. But Naveen, how are the numbers looking?
So, well, the strong move yesterday, Anuj, but yeah, numbers also seem to be meeting street estimates. In fact, in few parameters, they are above what the street was expecting. So revenue came in at a growth of 1% on a quarter-on-quarter basis, purely led by the realization increase. Remember, this is what Nomura was expecting, but margins, that is where the kicker has come in. That margins have come in at 23.5% versus a 20.4% on a quarter-on-quarter basis. This is clear jump on two reasons. One is that they are overall other expenses that have been coming down and the realization, so that operational leverage has been kicking in and margins have been coming positive. I expect the stock to be in green, but as you pointed out, the stock has already run up 9% yesterday. Stock is in F&O ban, so keep an eye on this stock. Back to you.
Okay, that's important. Yes, Sonia, I'm back to you. Air traffic growth, I'm not surprised. You have numbers to indicate that there's further growth in air traffic?
Yes, it's a third consecutive month of 17% plus air traffic growth. In fact, we'll get the chart up for you as well. It's 17.8% in the month of December, and passenger load factors once again have hit record highs of almost 90%. Now, if you look specifically for Indigo, the ASK, which is the average seat per kilometer that's used to measure its profitability, ASK has gone up by 18%, which is the strongest of the lot. SpiceJet has gone up by 15.5% and Jet has gone up by about 10.5%. Passenger growth for individual companies is also very strong. SpiceJet is the strongest at 18.2%. So I expect that stock to be in the green this morning. For Jet Airways, it's fine. It's been doing about 10 to 15% and that continues. We'll just get the air traffic growth up for you. For the months of December, November and October, it's been about 17% plus. September was 16.9% and so was August. So it's been a fairly healthy trend there.
Okay, yes, I think the only thing that will constrain it is airport space or airfield space. Sonal, you have a bunch of results on your radar?
Well, I'll start with the good one. Template
strong set of numbers. The revenue was up around 146% and the EBITDA came in higher by 89%. Though the margins contracted by 200 basis points, but the profits were up around 184%. However, on a sequential basis, there is some sort of compression on the margins. But I think on an yearly basis, the results are really good. However, we need to remember one more thing. The stock has given us returns of more than four times in last 1 year. So we'll keep a look at that stock today. The other result that I'm watching today is Sasken Tech. Weak numbers sequentially, though the revenue was up 6%, the EBIT was down around 16%, and the margins also contracted by 300 basis points, giving a profit decline of around 8.5%. Back to you.
Sonal, thanks a lot for that. Naveen, what about Rallis numbers?
A mixed set of numbers, Anuj, I would say. See, revenue growth over there for Rallis has been strong at 19%, majorly led by two things. One is that the Metahelix numbers, that has been coming overall well, and the Indian business has also been growing. But the margins, that is where the pressure has been seen clearly, coming in at 9.5% versus 12.5% year-on-year. What has led to margin decline? Again, Metahelix, which has given them a revenue kicker over there. Metahelix, the margins have come down by 200 basis points. Also, in their India business, the gross margins, they have come down, giving a not so hunky-dory picture for the margins. I expect the stock to be maybe in the light green on the back of that, the revenue growth the company has been seeing. Back to you.
Okay, thanks a lot for that. So that's Rallis. But let's talk about some other stocks that are in the news this morning. Ronit, what are you looking at today?
So actually, a couple of stocks on my radar. I'll start with Kalpataru Transmission. So they won orders worth around 871 crores. And these are basically for the design, supply, as well as construction of transmission line work for the railways. So expect that stock to be in the green. Moving on to Manappuram Finance, interesting company there. You know, they're having a board meet today to consider an investment proposal. Remember, the stock spiked more than 4% when they informed this to the exchanges. Moving on to HSIL, you know, they've started commercial production of first phase of their small size caps as well as their closures plant at Telangana. That's a positive move coming in there. IOC, so they have a board meet on Jan 30th to consider issuing bonus shares. And finally, moving on to Dr. Reddy's, Morgan Stanley have come out with a note on it. What they're saying is Dr. Reddy's has raised prices by 5% for two of its brands, that is the Senvio spray as well as the Zembrace in Jan 2018. Those will have a small financial impact and indicates the company's confidence in these two brands. So they're still overweight on that stock. Back to you.
Okay, thanks a lot, boys and girls, for giving us all of those stocks. Let's do a quick recap now of our top stocks to watch. Expected to gain are names like L&T, BHEL, Make Money Organics, Nosil, Just Dial, most of the aviation stocks, Rallis, Tinplate, Kalpataru Power on the order win, Manappuram Finance board meet today, HSIL, IOC and Dr. Reddy's. While stocks expected to be under pressure today, Asian Paints post a weak set of numbers, Axis Bank, Tata Motors and Sasken Technology.
I'm not so sure, going by the mood of the market, whether there will be that much red. But especially on Axis Bank, there are two views. There have been, genuine perceivable fall in GNPAs. And yet, if you looked at the BB and lower rated companies, that load has gone up a bit. So you make your judgment. Here's more from our chat with Jairam Sridharan, the CFO of Axis Bank.
In terms of slippages themselves, looking forward, most of the large ticket accounts that were stressed have already seen a slippage and hence recognition over the course of the last six, seven quarters. What you will continue to see is the next level of accounts in terms of size starting to flow through. So you should expect to see some of that happen. We don't offer any specific guidance on slippage numbers themselves. However, we do talk about credit costs where we have indicated that we expect credit costs for the full year to be in the 220 to 260 basis points range.
The non-watchlist slippages have also been quite high. What is the reason for that?
The key sectors that we have spoken about before continue to be the same from an asset quality perspective. Power, iron and steel, and infrastructure are the three main sectors from which you are seeing slippages. Power and these three together, if you look at the first 9 months, these three together contribute more than 60% of all the slippages that we have had. And what you should expect to see is in the coming quarters, a little bit more recognition in the power sector. Maybe iron and steel will come off because most of the recognition has happened. But power and infra, there is some more to be done, and infra, there might be a mild amount of recognition still to be done.